Hi, it's Paul here from selfhelpforlife.com, and in today's video I'm going to provide a summary of the famous book The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. And what I'll also do is go through each of those 7 habits in turn. Now, I bought this book back in 1994, so my copy's over 25 years old now at the time of recording this video. At that time it had sold 10 million copies, is now sold over 15 million copies, and most people have heard of the title even if they haven't heard of the author Stephen Covey. Now, if you're watching this video, you are probably interested in success habits and success strategies. So I've created a free ebook called 10 Strategies for Your Success. It goes into the top 10 things that successful people do to live an awesome life. You can get this ebook by going to selfhelpforlife.com/success, or you can click the first link in the description below or in the show notes if you're listening to the podcast version. Then enter your name and email and I'll send this ebook to you right away. So let's get into the 7 habits of highly effective people. Now, the first 3 habits are all about improving you, about improving yourself. And Stephen Covey calls this private victory. And the first of these habits, habit number 1, is to be proactive. And a large part of this habit is the idea of choosing how you respond to events that happen in your life. So it's really about taking responsibility. So many times a day we have stimuluses that happen. So we have situations, we have events, we have other people that might say something to us, and we respond to those. We respond by taking some kind of action or reacting. We might respond by a certain thought we have or a certain feeling we have. And these responses are typically unconscious. They're often done by instinct. They're often done by memory, so remembering what we did last time and then unconsciously acting the same way, or they're very habitual. But what Stephen Covey says is that there is a gap. There is a gap between the stimulus and how you respond. And it's what you do in that gap that's vital for changing this. Now, to be successful in changing your response, so changing what you do in that gap, requires first self-awareness. You need to notice that gap and actually stop doing the reactive behavior. It then requires some imagination to come up with a different or better response. Then it requires conscious. You need to know that that new response is right or wrong. You want to make sure it's a better choice. And then there's independent will, which is the ability to change your response. And when you think about the word responsibility, if you split that into 2 words, it's responsibility, which is your ability to change your response. Another important component of the first habit of being proactive is to know what you can and what you can't control. So there's 2 parts to this, and Stephen Covey calls the first part your circle of influence. So this is what you can control and what you can influence. So there's your direct actions, you have complete control over those. There's also indirect actions. This is when you do something or say something that influences someone else to do something. And the thing about this is that as your abilities and your skills improve, your ability to influence improves as well. So over time, when you work on yourself, you can develop greater influence. And then the other part is the circle of concerns. So this is things like the past. You can't change the past. This is also things like politics, recessions, larger world events that we have no direct control over. It's also the actions of most other people. Remember, we can't directly control other people, we can only influence them. And it's a waste of time and energy to focus on what you can't control. So that's really important. So knowing what you can control, knowing what you can influence, and not wasting time on things that you can't control. So habit 2 is to begin with the end in mind. Now, what I really like about this book is the habits follow a sequential order. They kind of make sense. It's almost like a step-by-step process. So you need to be proactive and you need to have a sense of control before you can figure out what you want to do with your life, before you can work out your what and your why. And when you don't do this, you tend to automatically become part of someone else's life. So think about, where do you want to be in 5 years' time, 10 years' time, or 15 years' time? It's very easy to climb up the wrong ladder in life. So let's say your ladder is achieving corporate success. That's what many people do without maybe thinking about it seriously. And so you get the money, you get the status, you get that corporate success. But you get there and you think, okay, well, I feel I've got no passion. I feel that I've got no real purpose, my life feels meaningless, and you realize then that you've been climbing up the wrong ladder. So going up the ladder of corporate success, where maybe there was a different ladder, a different path you wanted to follow. And a way to think about this as well, this helps you work out your purpose in life, is to think about how do you want to be remembered? So when you're at the end of your life, how do you want people to remember you? And think about whether the things you're doing at the moment are the things that you want to be remembered by. This habit is also about knowing your values. Your values determine who you are right now and who you want to be in the future. They drive the decisions you make and also the actions that you take. Another important part of this is to have a personal mission statement. Now, this doesn't need to be elaborate. Will Smith had a very simple mission statement, which is, I want the world to be better because I was here. So I want the world to be better because I was here. So it can be as simple as that. This habit is also about setting goals. Now, I'm not going to go into detail on goal setting right now, but if you're interested, there is a video on goal setting and achievement which will appear up here right now. And Stephen Covey also talks about the importance of visualizing the end point. So when you're doing that, deciding, is this actually what I really want? Is this really the life I want? Am I climbing the right ladder? So habit three is to put first things first. So we know that we have control and responsibility. That was habit one. We now know our what and our why. That was habit two. So habit three is all about the how. It's how to make this awesome life happen. So productivity is quite a big part of this habit. And Stephen Covey has a great quote, which is, the challenge is not to manage time, but to manage ourselves. Now, to help you maximize your productivity, Stephen Covey introduces the time management matrix. Now, this is not actually a new concept. It was originally created by Eisenhower, who was the 34th US president, but it was Stephen Covey that made this popular. And the main concept or idea behind the time management matrix is classifying tasks by importance and urgency. Now, the time management matrix consists of four quadrants. So quadrant one is tasks that are important and urgent. So typically these are tasks that are unexpected. So these are crises, these are pressing problems, but these can also be deadline driven projects. And I'll come back to those in a moment. But when you spend too much time in quadrant one, that can feel like you're firefighting. It can feel stressful, a lot of anxiety, and even burnout over time. Now, too much time in quadrant one can really affect your longer term goals and also your productivity on a daily basis. And the goal really is to not get anything into quadrant one that is within your control. So if you have assignments with longer term deadlines or anything you procrastinate on, you really want to be working on those in quadrant two, which I'll talk about in a moment, before the deadlines get so imminent that they end up being pushed into quadrant one. So the tasks in quadrant one are typically driven by other people, but they can be driven by you if you're disorganized and leave things to the last minute. So quadrant two is important, but not urgent. So these are your more important projects. These are your major pieces of work that have deadlines in the future. And the idea is you want to do this work now, not wait until the deadline is imminent. And that's what pushes it into quadrant one. This is also the objectives that you're often set at work in your annual appraisal. And you know, your pay rise and your productivity might be assessed on those objectives. A lot of those objectives often are quite long term. So it's those kind of things that are also in quadrant two. It's also the activities that you do towards your longer term goals and your mission and your values. Remember habit two, where we identified what those were. And the key thing about quadrant two is you drive the activities in this quadrant. And this is always the best quadrant to be in. So some examples could be building relationships, long-term planning, doing regular exercise, and also preparation. So really quadrant two is all the things that we should be doing, but we never do or often don't do because they never feel urgent. So to spend more time in quadrant two, you'll need to learn to say no to some urgent activities and learn how to delegate. And that can be hard sometimes, but you need to develop the ability to do that to ensure that the more important tasks and projects get done. Now, quadrant three is urgent but not important. And these are typically tasks that are driven by other people, and it's often because they feel they're urgent to them. But they're typically not things that you'll be measured on. They're not your goals. They're not the things that are your objectives in your career, for instance. But they are things that keep you busy, but they don't contribute to your mission, your values, or your high priority goals. Now, these include interruptions, some meetings, reports, and spending too much time checking emails. And often these tasks have a short-term focus, and if you spend too much time on them, you can feel that you're out of control. So quadrant four is not important and not urgent. So anything you put in this quadrant, you really want to question whether you need to do it at all. Can you delegate to someone else? Does it actually need to be done? So typically activities in here would include trivia, busy work, some emails, some phone calls, time-wasting activities. Now, if you spend too much time doing quadrant four activities, so busy work and work that's not adding much value, then eventually that will get noticed and you could get fired, or you'll find that you become too highly dependent on other people to get things done. So the first three habits were about you. The next three habits are about you and other people. And Stephen Covey calls this public victory. So habit number four is to think win-win. So this is seeking agreements, solutions, products and services that are beneficial and satisfying to both parties. And Stephen Covey identified a number of essential character traits for win-win. And these include integrity. So the ability to be honest and be correct. So that's doing the right thing, and also ethical and being trustworthy and keeping promises and commitments. Another character trait is maturity, and this is having a balance between courage or toughness and consideration or respect for other people. So this is about not leaving people behind, but it's also about making the right decisions, even knowing that this might sometimes make certain people unhappy. But it's getting the balance between doing the right things, performing the right actions, but also trying to bring people with you as you do that. Another character trait for win-win is abundance mentality. So this is the belief that there is enough for everyone, as opposed to having a scarcity mentality. And what Stephen Covey says is that if you can't get a win-win, then you should go for no deal instead. So it's got to be a win-win, otherwise there is no deal. So number five is to seek first to understand and then be understood. So this is about listening first and then speaking. And what Stephen says is that most people don't listen properly. Instead, they rush in and try to give good advice, often interrupting the person. Maybe you've done that yourself. I know I have on occasions. And most people are either speaking or preparing to speak, so they're not really listening. And when we do speak, we're responding with our autobiography, as he calls it, which is kind of like our view of the world, our map of the world. And we're not really understanding their autobiography, so their map or their view of the world. And personally, I completely get this, because when I'm talking to other people, I'd much rather understand their reality, understand their autobiography, the way that they do things, because I already know mine already, so it's much more interesting to know about someone else's. So I found this one quite easily personally, but if you struggle with this one, just think about it that way. Stephen then goes into the concept of empathic listening. So this is listening with the intent to understand. And there's four parts to this. The first part is to mimic content. So this is repeating or feeding their words back. So when you do this, you really have to listen to the other person if you're going to be able to feed those words back. Then there's rephrasing the content. So this is saying it back, but now in your own words. So now you have to think about what they've said, as opposed to just repeating it back. Then there's reflecting their feelings. So this is focusing more on how the other person feels rather than what they say. So this really helps you empathize with them. And then the fourth bit is to rephrase the content and reflect the feelings. So this is putting the content and the feelings and emotions behind it in your own words. So number six is synergize. So this is about working together. It's the idea that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, and also that a successful team can achieve far more than the individuals could achieve on their own. So this is about understanding and valuing differences and seeing things from other people's perspectives. It's also about looking for the good in others and about putting yourself in their shoes. So seeing the situation as if it's from their eyes, from their belief system, from their values, that kind of thing. And it's also about valuing other people's opinions. And many people are not very good at doing that. So that's really important too. So we've now covered six of the seven habits. Habits 1 to 3 were about improving yourself. Habits 4 to 6 were about improving your relationships with others. So the last habit, habit number 7, which is called sharpen the saw, is about continuous self-growth, continuous improvement, and continuous learning. Now in the book, Stephen talks about this guy that's sawing wood and it's taking him 5 hours to do it, and he's really working hard at it, but not making a great deal of progress. And then someone comes up to him and says, well, why don't you sharpen the saw? And he says, well, I haven't got time to do that. I'm too busy. So the analogy behind sharpening the saw is about taking time out to learn, to become better, so you can be more effective at things and also do them more quickly. So in this book, Stephen talks about the 4 dimensions of self-growth. So the first one being physical. So this is healthy eating, getting plenty of rest and relaxation, and also exercising regularly. Then the spiritual. So this is inner peace and calmness. So taking time out to meditate, to pray, or to read, and to connect with something bigger, whatever that is for you. Then there's mental, and this is education and constant learning. Now, when the book was written back in 1989, that mainly involved reading. That was the main way you learned. But of course, now we've got videos, podcasts, online courses, and many other ways that we can learn. So this is really about personal development. And then the last one, social and emotional. This is about spending time with family and friends and basically living habits 4 to 6 in everyday life. So these are the 7 habits as identified and explained by Stephen Covey in his best-selling book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And I'll put a link to the book on Amazon in the description below. I also encourage you to grab my free 10 Strategies for Your Success ebook. You can get that by going to selfhelpforlife.com/success or by clicking the first link in the description below or the first link in the show notes if you're listening to the podcast version. Then just enter your name and email and I'll send that to you right away. So I'd like to thank you for taking the time to watch this video, and I look forward to sharing more great content with you very soon. Bye for now.